One of the most common approaches to modeling behavior in economics is called discrete choice analysis. And here's the main idea. Each person is going to make a single choice from a finite set of options. For example, how do you get to work? You can choose to take a car, the bus, or ride a bike. What we're going to do is describe each one of these options by its characteristics. How much does it cost? What's the total travel time? And how comfortable is it? Then we assume that each person has some way of combining all of these characteristics into a ranking that we call a utility function. So one person might care about cost, but not comfort, and they're going to choose the bus. A different person might care about comfort, but not cost, and they'll choose the car. We call these their preferences. So different people may have different preferences. Now, in our data, we're going to observe the market shares. These are the percentage of people who take the bus, the percentage of people who take a car, and the percentage of people who ride a bike to work. That is our outcome variable in this kind of analysis. Our treatment variables, or our policy variables, are the characteristics themselves. So the cost of the bus, the cost of a car, and the cost of riding the bike. Now, what discrete choice analysis does is it uses this data on the characteristics and the market shares to learn about people's preferences over these different characteristics. Now, once we have these preferences, there's a whole lot of interesting things we can do. One thing we could do is think about what would happen if we doubled the price of the bus. So a local government might want to increase revenues by raising bus prices. Well, that's probably going to cause some people to stop riding the bus and shift to another option. So exactly how many people, though? What percentage of people are going to switch to other options? So how will the market share of buses change if we change the cost of a bus? Well, that's one thing we could answer if we knew people's preferences. Another thing we could do is predict what would happen if we introduced a new form of transportation. So for example, if we built a subway system, how many people would take the subway? How many people would keep riding a car? How many people would keep riding a bus? How many people would keep riding the bike? Well, we could answer this if we knew people's preferences. And the reason is that we think of this new mode of transportation as just another bundle of characteristics. So what exactly is a subway? Well, it's just a specific cost, a specific comfort, and a specific total travel time. So if we know people's preferences over this, we can predict exactly what percentage of people would prefer the subway versus the other existing alternatives. And so we could predict what the demand for the subway system would be. Now, we could use this to answer a whole bunch of other questions, like what if the government built an intercity high-speed rail line? That's also just a new mode of transportation. So if we did that, we could predict how many people would ride that instead of airplanes or intercity buses or just taking cars. So this is the basic idea behind discrete choice analysis. And it can be used in many other situations as well, like how do people choose what city to live in? How do firms choose where to locate? How do consumers choose what kind of cars to buy? How do people choose which airlines to ride? Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So this is one of the main ways that economists model people's choices and make predictions about different specific policies we're interested in.